Welcome to another edition of County Connection. I'm your host, Berks County Commissioner Christian Leinbach, and this is part one of a two-part series on the amazing Colebrookdale Railroad. I hope you enjoy your tour of one of the gems of Berks County, the Colebrookdale Railroad. I'm here with Nathaniel Guest. Nathaniel is the Executive Director of the Colebrookdale Railroad Preservation Trust. Nathaniel, thank you very much for opening up the train, the Colebrookdale Railroad, to our viewers today.
It's my pleasure. It's a pleasure to have you here.
We are getting ready to take a tour of what I consider to be one of the most amazing gems here in Berks County, and we're glad to have you lead us on that tour.
Well, we're very proud to have you, and we considered it a pretty special place as well. So I look forward to sharing it with you and our visitors.
Great. Well, let's get on board.
Thank you.
All aboard!
Well, we're on board the Colebrookdale Railroad and we're rolling south towards Pottstown. Nathaniel, why don't you give our viewers a little bit of a tour of the various cars of the Colebrookdale Railroad?
So, Commissioner, right now we're on our open car called the Secret Valley Explorer. This is a really unique car. It was built in 1910 by the Rutland Railroad, or for the Rutland Railroad, mm-hmm. and it served as a flat car. And it used to haul granite blocks from quarries in New England to the construction site of buildings all over the countryside. When we got the car, we rebuilt it as this basically hayride on rails. And in fact, in the fall, we actually do put hay out here and pumpkins, and you can enjoy hot cider as you see the beautiful foliage going down the line to Pottstown. During the rest of the year, it's decorated similar to what you see today, and it provides a wonderful way to view the absolutely stunning scenery between here and Pottstown. In fact, the scenery, as you'll see during the course of our trip, is really unexpectedly beautiful. Deep valleys, tall forests, rushing creeks, and there's no better way to see it than out here on the open car.
Having been on this railroad, I've got to tell you, if you come out, the cars are amazing, and we'll see those in a minute, but you absolutely want to spend some time on this open car to really get the feel of the beauty of the ride between Boyertown and Pottstown.
We've had a number of weddings on board the railroad, out here on this car and in the coach, but this is always the spot for the reception.
Absolutely.
So very good.
Take us into the passenger car.
Very good, we'll do. Commissioner, this is car 4970. It's our coach car, our deluxe coach car. This is essentially the baseline accommodation. This would be steerage on any other railroad, but as you can see, this is pretty spectacular for our baseline accommodation. This car was built in 1919 by the Pullman Company for the Canadian National Railway. It was originally built as an immigrant sleeping car, so in each of these pairs of windows, there was a bed. Not only a lower berth, but an upper berth that pulled down from the ceiling. In 1954, the Canadian National converted the car to a coach, which is the form that we received it in. However, when we received it, it had no floor, no ceiling, no windows, no paneling, no bathrooms, no heat, no sound, and no lights. Apart from that, it was in great shape. So we've done a lot of work to rebuild it and taking it back to its appearance as it would have looked sometime about 1919. The car is very popular. It seats 78 people, and it's on all of our trains. So the car has the number 4970, which was its historical number, but each Pullman car also had a name. And this car is called the Dawn Treader after the C.S. Lewis novel, The Voyage of the Dawn Treader. And the decoration inside the car refers to various scenes in that book. So if folks are familiar with The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, they'll recognize certain of the patterns in the wood and the coloration that gives the car its meaning. Each of the cars has a name and a personality that's reflected in its decor and its history.
So Nathaniel, we're here in the cafe car right now. Tell us a little bit about the background, history, and the restoration, because you've already started the restoration project here in the car.
That's right. Each of our cars is a work in progress. They're all very historic, and they were all very beautiful when they were built. But when we received them, they were essentially derelict. They were projects to start with. The cafe car was built in the 1920s for the Canadian National Railway. And when we got it, it had no seats, and so our passengers actually sat on hay bales when it first started. And we've been working through an iterative process to restore each of our cars. And all of our work is done by volunteers, which is amazing. Everyone who's working on the train today is a volunteer. Everyone who restores the track, everyone who restores these coaches is a volunteer. And you can see the beauty of their craftsmanship in the coach, and you'll see it in the parlor car, which are the cars that are most furthest along in their reconstruction. This car is unique in all of the world, not just because of its history, but also the value that this car will have to our passengers. This car will be fully handicapped accessible, which is amazing because, as you can imagine, a car built at the turn of the last century, the turn of the 1900s, they weren't thinking about accessibility. And so our volunteers have reconstructed this car to include a very large door on both sides that enables wheelchairs of any size to come on board. It will have a family-friendly, handicapped-accessible bathroom, as well as lounge space, dining space, and coach seating space. So there's a lot of really wonderful work happening in this car. The interior that you see is a provisional interior. This is the backing paneling, and we've decorated it as a garden cafe. It's very beautiful. Passengers really love it. A lot of folks take pictures in here. The paneling that will go in here eventually is from a very rare car built by the Wagner Palace Car Company in the 1890s. It's one of only 10 such cars left in the country. That interior is being restored by our volunteers and will be installed in this car next year. Some of the work that gives you a taste of what this car will look like are these stained glass windows. These were done by a volunteer who's riding our train today. Her name is Anita, and she recreated these windows to original Pullman Company patterns, and they're all from scratch, they're all real stained glass, and they really do help to create the flavor of a grander era in American passenger travel.
We have Fran and Crystal, and they are adorned in authentic Pullman style jackets. They are the wait staff here on the cafe car for the Colebrookdale Railroad.
So from this vantage point, you can see some of the original fabric of the car that you wouldn't otherwise normally see. So the curved portions of the clerestory, the upper portions of the clerestory, normally those are covered over by fancy paneling. And right now we're working on that fancy paneling, as I mentioned, it's from the late 1800s, and it's being restored. And so it will be reinstalled in the car. But until that happens, this car provides a neat experience to see some of the bones that make up the infrastructure of a 100-plus-year-old railroad car. We're very lucky to have among our volunteer corps some restoration specialists who are world-class. And Tom Hendricks is a cabinet maker. He's a full-time volunteer, and he created the doors on board our train. And as you can see, they're absolutely works of art. So we've made our way into the Colebrookdale Railroad's dining car. The car is called the Lion Gardener. This is a very important car on board the Colebrookdale because dining is a critical function of what we do. Railroad dining was an event during the golden era of passenger travel, and the Colebrookdale recreates that. We serve some of the finest food you'll find anywhere in Berks County on board our dining car. And the dining car itself, just like the cafe car that we were just in, is in the process of restoration. Like the cafe car, this car underwent a major restoration of its exterior last year, including all new steelwork, new roof, new floor, and new stained glass, as well as new windows. This year we're working on the interior. So what you see is essentially the backer paneling that our volunteers have put in, and our volunteers are hard at work, supported by thousands and thousands of dollars donated by people who believe in the Colebrookdale Railroad project. The donations and that volunteer labor are putting this car back into service, and it will truly be one of the most beautiful dining cars anywhere in the country. Where we're currently standing will be a round room. This is the lobby. And above me you can see the framework that will support a 1,600-piece stained glass dome that will be situated in here. An absolutely beautiful and stunning skylight, and a wonderful way to enter for the culinary experience that awaits you on board the Colebrookdale Railroad. And as you can see behind me, our dining staff is serving a 5-course meal that's provided today by Gracie's, a 5-star restaurant located along our line in Pine Forge. We have a full selection of gourmet beverages on board the Colebrookdale Railroad, including specialty coffees, as well as a full bar serving alcoholic drinks, beers, wines, and spirits, all produced in the area around the Colebrookdale. And all of our drinks are served in keepsake Colebrookdale Railroad glasses. We're in our first-class parlor car, the Storm King. This car, just like the rest of the cars in our train, was completely gutted and rebuilt and is, as you can see, one of the most beautiful railroad cars anywhere in the country. There's a full bar behind you, as well as a baby grand piano from 1914 of mahogany that matches the rest of the car's interior. And this is one of the few places where you can actually listen to a grand piano on board the train as we make our way along the line. We have uniformed attendants who serve in the car. Today we have Jerry and Mike, and they attend to our passengers' every need in the grand tradition of railroad passenger travel of the last century.
Welcome aboard.
I hope you've enjoyed the tour of the various cars, but right now I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the history. Not so much the history of the railroad back to the 1800s, but how did the Colebrookdale Railroad become the Colebrookdale Railroad Preservation Trust? I think the first thing our folks need to know is that the County of Berks made a tough decision a number of years ago, back in 2008, to save this railroad from abandonment. At that point in time, there was no Colebrookdale Railroad Preservation Trust. Ultimately, we saved it. We tried to make it operate under a private operator for freight. That didn't work. And then one day, you came along with the dream for the Colebrookdale Railroad Secret Valley Line, and the rest, so to speak, is history. I'd like you to tell us a little bit about what your dream was and what's happened over the last several years to bring us to where we are today.
Well, I need to start out by saying that what has happened on the Colebrookdale, I think history will look back upon and recognize as really nothing short of a miracle. And I've not been witness to many miracles in my life, and the way in which this one has unfolded is because of the extraordinary commitment of extraordinary people such as yourself and the other commissioners at Berks County, Ken Pick of the Redevelopment Authority. Berks County, I hope the citizens of Berks County recognize how lucky they are to have such wonderful leadership in you and Ken Pick. And I believe that the way in which the Colebrookdale has unfolded, and we can do the facts and figures about how the trust got started, but in looking at it at a macro level, it really is nothing short of a miracle. So I was in law school when I read in a newspaper article about this line being threatened with abandonment, and I had grown up in the area, and after church on Sundays, my grandfather would take me to go watch trains, and one of the places we used to go watch trains was here on the Colebrookdale.
Coffee service?
Oh, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Much appreciated. Thank you, Greg.
Appreciate it.
So we used to come and watch trains, and my grandfather once said to me, and I must have all of about 5 years old, that that would be a wonderful tourist railroad. It's a beautiful line, and nobody knows how important it was historically. So that stuck with me, and when I read this 30 years later, I knew we had to do something. And so I got in touch with the commissioners of Berks County and said, you know, if we ever lose this railroad line, it's a loss from a freight perspective, because this is Berks County's link to the national freight network on the eastern side. Additionally, there's a tremendous opportunity here for community and economic development, both for Pottstown and for Boyertown. And things just kind of fell in place. I began working on it, and we were successful, and there was an abandonment case that was before the Surface Transportation Board. And you don't often win those. And through divine providence, or however history will choose to interpret it, we won. And like the dog that catches the car and goes, now what? We had to figure out how we put this together. And so I remember my stepfather, who's here on board the train with us today, he was the principal of the law firm where I was working. He came to me and said, well, you know, you're not going to be able to make this work working here. You need to work on this full time. And so with $15,000 in the bank, in the railroad's bank account, which I had raised by selling my model train collection, I left my job and began trying to figure out the fundraising and the planning for this project. The dream had long existed. I had always known if I had the opportunity to create a tourist railroad, we were going to do something that was spectacular, that represented the highest level of passenger service in the Grand Era, that you can't really experience anywhere outside of the Orient Express. Now, achieving that vision was another matter, particularly with $15,000 in the bank.
Let me jump in here, Nathaniel. One of the things that really impressed me early on was when you said to us as county commissioners, I'm so committed to this, I'm leaving the law firm and I'm jumping into this full time. There are a lot of people with great ideas, but there are very few people I meet in life that are willing to put everything they have behind that idea. And you traded in your model train collection for the real thing.
Yeah, we upgraded the size.
And if you hadn't done that, we wouldn't be here.
Well, and thank you. What's made this a miracle is that folks believed in that dream too, including you and the other commissioners and Ken Pick. And 2 weeks after I left my law firm, a check arrived in the mail for $50,000 from a donor who I had never met before, I had never spoken to before, who had caught wind of the dream that was in store for the Colebrookdale and believed in it enough to invest in it. And that money got us started. And then it was by other folks, other volunteers, other donors buying into it that you have the beautiful train you see today.
Let's talk about that, because donations and volunteers have been a huge part of the success. And I think in a real way, you've taken your passion, you've shared it with donors, you've shared it with potential donors and with volunteers. And other than the initial dollars to buy the railroad and some early maintenance before you were on board, no pun intended,
right,
this has been done by donations and volunteers. And we're not talking tens of thousands of dollars of work. We're talking hundreds of thousands of dollars, maybe more.
So the initial investment that was made in the line has been multiplied at least 10 times over by the private investment, just private dollars that have come into the line from all over the country, from folks that are excited about what's happening here. We've also raised money from the federal and state level, supporting the community and economic development goals. And since we've started, the Colebrookdale has invested over $2 million in the local economy each year. And 15 new businesses have opened in Boyertown around the railroad just because of the railroad being present. And we're poised to invest another $1.5 million in the downtown in Boyertown next year. The volunteer commitment is really, it is as big a miracle as the saving of the railroad. In fact, it's why we've been able to save the railroad.
Absolutely.
In 2016, the White House recognized the Colebrookdale Railroad with the highest honor for a preservation project anywhere in the country, an honor that we share with Independence Mall and Falling Water. We're the only three sites in Pennsylvania to have that Preserve America Steward designation, so we're very proud of that. Each year, our volunteers give about 150,000 hours of community service to the railroad.
One other thing before we end part one of our program, we tie two communities together, Pottstown, Boyertown. We tie two counties together, Berks County and Montgomery County. And the leaders in Montgomery County, prior commissioners and current commissioners, have been very supportive, as have the leaders in both Pottstown and Boyertown. And that support has been absolutely critical.
That's one of the things that makes the Colebrookdale unique, both in terms of its attributes and the reasons for its success, that railroads have a unique capacity to connect people. Our railroad connects not just people and places, but also the past and the future. The fact that Pottstown and Boyertown have both recognized the value of the railroad for their economic future has been part of the reason why we've been as successful as we've been. 30,000 people from every state in the country and up to 12 foreign nations every year come to ride the Colebrookdale's trains. And that's a pretty
phenomenal. Amazing in just a short period of time. We're going to wrap up part one of this show by going back to the baby grand piano.
As we listen to Matt play the baby grand piano here in the parlor car, I want to say thank you for joining us for another edition of County Connection. I'm your host, Commissioner Christian Leinbach, asking you to join us for part two of County Connection and the Colebrookdale Railroad next time.